Sono giornalista inglese e professore a London School of Economics. That's all the Italian I know. My name is Charlie Beckett, and I'm chairing this session today on constructive journalism. And if you've looked at the news today, any kind of news, this is just the International New York Times. We've got turning captives into killers. We've got the migrant deal shutting down the economy in Turkey. We've got ISIS gaining ground, getting extra money, killing more people. We've even got Facebook groups acting as a weapons bazaar. Any kind of news that you look at this morning is going to make you as depressed as the weather is in Perugia today. And it's very clear that people are feeling overwhelmed, inundated by the kind of negative tsunami of bad information that they're getting from any kind of news source. And the problem with that is that it's not entirely reality. Even in somewhere like Italy, actually people are better off, healthier, live more peaceful lives than they've ever done before in history. Most of us are relatively happy in our lives, and yet journalism tells us all the time that we should be shocked, depressed, and worried, and fearful. So is this a good thing? That's what we're going to be looking at today, and we're going to be looking at it in a very kind of practical way. We're going to be looking at with three people who in some ways are trying to reinvent news, partly perhaps for kind of ethical reasons that they want. They think that somehow journalism can make the world perhaps a better place, not just a better informed place, but also, frankly, perhaps for business reasons, that if we all we do as journalists is tell people that life is shit, then it may be that they don't actually want to listen to us anymore. So we've got three great people to talk about this. We've got Craig Silverman from Buzzfeed Canada. We've got Karel from the Correspondent in Holland, but we're going to kick off with Cathrine, who's going to talk about what we mean by constructive journalism. So you're going to get kind of two presentations, then Craig's going to kick in. And obviously, we've got an hour, so we're going to try and be quick, and we want to try and get feedback and questions from you as well. So participate in this as well. But Cathrine, would you like to kick us off?
Thank you so much. So if I can get my slides on the screen, that would be fantastic. Oh, that's Rob.
That's the wrong one.
This one over here?
The next one, that one.
Yeah. So we've set up a website at the Windesheim University where I'm currently working with this domain. So if you want even more examples, if you want definitions, if you want to look into the research that's underpinning what we're doing, please visit this website. We also have a sign up email here if you want to follow the work. So just to let you know that resource is out there. First, let me just very briefly address what I call the pink elephants in this domain. I don't know how you feel about constructive journalism. Maybe you are convinced, maybe you're skeptical, and I invite all these criticism in here, but something that needs to be said first off is constructive elements in journalism is not making it fluff. It's not making it uncritical. It's just focusing on resources, on solutions, on future perspectives. So it's not about not being critical. It's just about the focus. And it's not about disregarding facts, but it's about presenting facts maybe in other ways, in a bigger context. and it's about the interviewing we do with sources. What kind of questions do we ask? So that's some of the pink elephants in the room that's usually there, and I hope to be able to address them and say it up front. This definition behind me has six bullets, and this is the working definition that we have established at the University of Windesheim, where I'm currently working, and that's from this definition that we try to build the work. So constructive journalism is adding a solution-oriented framing of news. It conveys a productive perspective about the future and our ability to get there. It's critical, but never cynical. It puts new questions to power, so-called victims and experts, inquiring about resources, collaborations, and solutions on issues of high societal significance. It utilizes data to create infographics, explaining the news, so we go from covering incidents to providing a bigger context. And the last one is, we strive to engage and empower the public and optimally co-create with them. And the expert on that co-creation is right here at this table, the correspondent. And I look forward to hear about what Buzzfeed is doing on that too. So that's the definition that I work with and we work with at Windesheim. But you, Charlie, wanted me to be specific. So let me, I don't know, do you want me to show the examples,
yeah,
or should we move?
Just show at least one example.
Yeah,
definitely.
Okay. For instance, this first article up here is an older one from New York Times. And the journalist who wrote this is Tina Rosenberg, one of the founders of Solutions Journalism, which is an organization in the US that specializes in solutions approaches within journalism. This is the article she wrote back in 2001, talking about how Brazil has solved the AIDS crisis. And this article stirred so much attention in the UN that policies were changed for Africa. And Tina Rosenberg tells me that it was this article that convinced her that she needed to change how she covered the world. And it was really an eye-opener for her, so that was a start for the solutions journalism approach. That's one example. And of course, New York Times still have the solutions articles there. Let's see, they have the fixes column section where they have solutions articles. Recently, The Economist had this, interesting.
That's not very constructive.
No. Well, let's go back. Okay, so the 6th of February, they had a cover story with the headline, How to Manage the Migrant Crisis. So it's talking about the refugee situation, it's outlining the, you know, big, big problem it is for Europe, but it's also pointing to how can this be managed, and it's using data to try to give us, the reader, some context. The Guardian has the way they cover climate change under the headline, Keep It in the Ground. They also had constructive stories in there, and classical stories. So I would love to show you just this short example of how they made a short video, if it's gonna work, I hope so, where they tried to give us another approach to China. China is the big polluter in the world, but are there any signs that China is changing policies? Are there any signs that China is actually could go from being the big bad guy in climate and pollution to being, I don't want to use the word savior, but with potential. So let me show you this video, if we have sound. Thank you. So of course, this is not a long article, but it shows you the approach that The Guardian has also put into the way that they cover climate and China and climate change. Looking at the possibilities, looking at where are the signs of progress, and what will happen to the world if this progress is being achieved. The last short example I want to show you is the power of a future-oriented question. This is really giving me a hard time. So the power of a future-oriented question. When you ask a politician, when we look at the journalists' question to politicians, they are mostly looking at things that has happened. We act as detectives. Who did what when, and why did you say that, and how does that correspond with what's happening right now? We rarely ask questions to politicians about where will we go from here, what now, what are the future visions you have, and how can we achieve them? But I want to show you this brief clip from CBS 60 Minutes from a press conference where Secretary John Kerry was asked a very specific question from one of the reporters. And I'm showing you this clip to give you an impression of the power of a future-oriented question. So, and we can discuss it after, but let me just show you this clip about that.
The apparent breakthrough on...
Let's start it again. No sound?
Syria came during a news conference when the CBS News State Department correspondent Margaret Brennan asked you a question.
Is there anything at this point that his government could do or offer that would stop an attack?
Sure. He could turn over every single bit of his chemical weapons to the international community in the next week. Turn it over. All of it.
Was the answer to that question as seat of the pants as it appeared? Or did you walk into the room intending to say something like that?
I didn't walk into the room intending to say it because I didn't know what question I was going to be asked, but I certainly answered it purposefully and intentionally, and Margaret Brennan asked a terrific question. It was a good question. It deserved an honest answer.
The answer exposed what had been a private Russian proposal. Vladimir Putin, Syria's ally, told President Obama Syria might surrender its chemical arsenal. Kerry went to Geneva to work on details with Russian Foreign Minister Sergei Lavrov.
Yeah, and I think I'll end it here because I can speak for the whole hour and I don't want to do that. But this is an example of the power of future-oriented question. And I know it's controversial, but it has a lot of potential, and that's what we also work in.
Great. Good way to start. Karel, you've got some more examples of trying to actually put this into practice as a journalist. Please. Right.
Well, if the slides can go up, I can briefly introduce myself and the medium I work for. My name is Karel Smouter. I'm deputy editor-in-chief of The Correspondent, which is somewhat notorious among journalists for being the world record in crowdfunding. In 2013, we raised 1.3 million euros to basically get started. Well, we have been doing so over the past 2.5 years, and we now have a readership of 50,000 paying members contributing to our journalism. But I will not talk about that for too long, because I was hoping to share some real practical examples of how we implement constructive elements in our story. So one key thing to understand about The Correspondent is that we see ourselves as a daily antidote against the hype of the day. Instead of breaking news, we try to bring breaking news, but then with an apostrophe in between the W and the S. So breaking new insights into the world that we live, from news to new. And in order to get there, you need constructive journalism. So I will share 7 tricks out of our little handbook that we use with our editors. The first one being, kill the victim. We especially use this in our foreign issues type of stories. We have a network of freelancers, like all media have, who report from all over the world. And the type of pitches I receive as deputy editor are usually like, well, there's an election coming up and things look really bad. Can I report on that? Because democracy isn't as far as it is in your in the Netherlands or in Europe. Or so have you basically used the West as a comparison for the rest of the world? And well, they don't meet that standards. And also, if you report on crises and conflicts, it's usually the victims you see. I used to report a lot on the refugee crisis before it was called crisis. I tried myself really hard not to see victims, but see survivors, see people who've actually managed to get themselves away from a very bad situation. And sometimes killing the victim also means reframing the problem or finding, for instance, someone who can serve as the protagonist for a story. So this particular story that I'm showing here is about deforestation in Ethiopia. Well, I can tell you, usually those type of stories really don't do that much in terms of people reading that type of stories. But we managed to reframe this story in such a way that it engaged, well, thousands of our readers. The story headline reads, "This recipe against deforestation sounds too good to be true, yet it isn't." And it follows a person who has a recipe against the issue of deforestation, instead of just raising the issue. So, and well, the second thing I always highlight when I talk to our editors and our freelancers is, and Cathrine already mentioned that briefly as well, this is not a soft technique. It can actually serve as a way to open up closed environments or to make people talk who usually wouldn't talk to journalists. One example I can give from my own work as a migration correspondent, I spent a month at the repatriation service, as you call it, I think. This is the branch of government in the Netherlands that is assigned to basically deport refugees who have failed to receive an asylum status and deport them back to their countries. Well, this is a group of people that, for instance, at birthday parties wouldn't actually say what they're working at. I mean, it's a very, very sensitive topic, as it is everywhere in the world right now. So what I tried doing while I was there and witnessed as much as I could as a journalist was, instead of always attack them and ask them, why, how can you live for yourself doing this? Or I asked them, okay, if you would be the minister, what would you do? If you would advise your superiors, how would you better do your job, basically? And one of the key insights that a lot of these people working there, the actual executors of these restrictive policies, always brought up is, well, I want to bring in more psychology, for instance. I want to be more of a welfare worker instead of, you know, a prison guard kicking people out. So I ended this this month with this story in five steps to a different repatriation service. So, and what I really noticed while doing this was that by asking these type of different questions, people actually started to open up. They didn't go into the defensive mode. And also the spokesperson who was there all the time when I was in their offices and talked to their people, yeah, was caught completely off guard because I started to ask this type of questions. Because she prepared her employees for the type of questions that they usually get. So it's a way to surprise and to play the game with spokespeople in a different way as well. Well, another example of a foreign story we did differently used the world outside of Europe as a surprising example or as a shining example that you can actually learn from instead of always, you know, going to other places and finding out how they are not like us. So this is a story on a Mexican village that established their own mobile network in order to be free from the big companies there. You can also do this with history. Use history to put the now, to put the present into perspective. So by the end of 2013, we did this story on 2013 being the best year ever. We showed progress in 10 graphics, how analphabetism dropped dramatically, how extreme poverty dropped dramatically, how tolerance towards homosexuality improved drastically. Well, all these type of different graphs that actually show a long-term perspective on the news, basically, which is really different. The particular journalist I'm talking about here is called Rutger Bregman. He is our progress correspondent. Because one thing we always say is a quote from Joris Luijendijk, a famous Dutch journalist, who says, if you follow the news the whole day, by the end of the day, you know exactly how the world is not working. So journalists really have a hard time usually covering anything but what happened yesterday or what happened today. So what is happening tomorrow? So, well, this new book will be out in the English language as well. It's called Utopia for Realists. You can check it out on our website. And it's full of future-oriented perspective, basically. I have two more examples of how we do this. One other way is also to compare with history and to put things into perspective. An example that I'm showing here is how the Greeks last summer were, of course, held accountable by the Troika, and we basically dived into history and we looked at all the major bailouts that happened, and the country that surprisingly had the most bailouts in history turned out to be Germany, the country that is actually holding the Greeks accountable. So that was this type of story. One other thing, we always ask our journalists as well to start off their journeys, their stories with a what-if question. So this is our drugs correspondent asking the question, what if all drugs would be legal? And this is a question that gives you a different direction to work in, basically. Well, sometimes we also explore the boundaries, you can say, between journalism and, well, attempts to change the world. As many other outlets, we have reported extensively on how banks are failing the public, basically. But last summer, we sat together and we thought, well, why are we not changing the banks that we're in? We all know about banks being evil, but somehow we don't really get into action. So we called Let's Change from Bank Week, where we asked our readers to pick a different bank in 1 week. And about 10,000 people did that week. So this is an example of how you can actually contribute to change sometimes as well, instead of just talking about it or writing about it. Well, these were some examples of how we use constructive elements in our actual stories. But one important element that is also part of constructive journalism in our eyes is, well, see members of your publication not as consumers consuming your product, but as people who can contribute their knowledge, their curiosity, their expertise to your stories. We insistently use the word contributions instead of comments, or instead of reactions, you know. So this is actually from this week. We found a new way, basically, to improve this comment section that we have, this contribution section, as we call it. Our journalists are now asked to highlight the best comments, to basically talk back to anyone who gives something constructive, contributing to the story. But also one thing we noticed after we were busy for about a year is that we were different in many ways as a news outlet, but we were still predominantly white, predominantly city-based, predominantly male even. So we decided to diversify the people who work for us. So we basically called for aspiring journalists with a different background than ours to come and join us, basically. And hundreds of them actually did, and we are working with many of them right now. So you can also use your crowd, your people, to actually change even your staff by this constructive approach. And the final thing I want to say is, if things actually change, report back. So not just write one story and then leave the readers to it. But if something actually happens with the story or with the issue that you raised, talk back. For instance, this week we had a follow-up on a story we did last year about how judges usually use very complex language for their verdicts. And it called for a different language in the courtroom. And this, just this last week, it was announced that, also based on this article, the civil court in the Netherlands decided to basically reinvent their dictionary and use different words so that the people that have to deal with this verdict can actually understand what they're talking about. So if things change as a result of your journalism, report back. So, and if your members contribute something, praise them for it, because we are in a dialogue with our readers instead of just sending. Well, this is all very quick. I hope to talk more later.
Thanks very much. Thanks very much, Karel. Loads of great examples of how to do constructive journalism. Hands up those of you who have ever looked at BuzzFeed. All right, who hasn't looked at BuzzFeed? When you looked at BuzzFeed, hands up if it made you laugh. Yeah, it's not supposed to do that, is it, the news? Anyway, Craig Silverman, BuzzFeed.
I wrote all the things that made you laugh. That was just me. So I'll sort of maybe add things from two perspectives. So one is sort of the approach we have at BuzzFeed and where an element of sort of positivity comes into that, where some of it is news and some of that is not news and is entertainment. And then the other piece of it is I've spent a little more than a decade sort of looking at misinformation, accuracy, and in particular, debunking of misinformation, which in some ways I think is a constructive thing to do, but it's interesting because, and this is the thread between that and BuzzFeed, a lot of this psychology and emotion play a big role in this kind of stuff. And so there's a couple things to be said about that. So in terms of BuzzFeed, you know, as I said, we do some news and we do some that is entertainment. So typically when you see something that's a list, it's someone who's not a journalist writing that. But we are aiming to appeal to people's emotions. And at the core of it is trying to write something that people can relate to. So it could be a list about, you know, 27 things you'll know if you grew up in this particular part of a country, or 27 things you'll know if you're a fan of this TV show. And so we have groups of people who are, again, they're not journalists, but they're really trying to think about how do I write things that someone is going to read, and as they go down the list, they're going to be nodding their head the entire time and think, this is me, this is my life, or this is something that I can relate to. And what we take from that on the news side is that concept of relatability, but also, you know, appealing without manipulating, but appealing to people's emotions, because that's what makes them act. It's one, it will make them actually read the whole thing. And in coming to BuzzFeed, I've been shocked by how far down people actually read compared to what I've experienced at news organizations. And that's because people are really engaged at that level. So appealing to them and seeing themselves in something makes them complete it, makes them read it. And of course, the thing that we care about a lot is it makes them share it as well. And that helps it spread. And so those are very core things. And when we apply that to news, we do what we call social news, which is often stories that, you know, it might be trending on a social network or what have you, but oftentimes there's a story that at the core of it, there's some kind of core emotion that people can identify with. And so we do write a lot of news stories that have kind of a heartwarming angle to them. And people do enjoy reading those and do enjoy sharing those. But, you know, you also go to the other side that one of the most powerful emotions to get people to share something is disgust. So you can have something that is very heartwarming, that makes somebody feel good and they want to share it, and that's nice, and that gets out into the world and sort of spreads that. But you can also go to the other side where you write something about an issue that gets people really upset, and they'll share that. Or it could be something like, you know, a piece of food that somebody has come up with that's really gross, and people will share that like crazy. But there is a bridge between these two things, and so I thought I'd give a couple examples of stories we've done. So one of them is a story I wrote. There was a woman, an Aboriginal woman in Canada, who had gone to a mall, and it was Halloween, and she was there with her two children, and she saw that this store had hired a woman to wear a Pocahontas costume and was painting people's faces. And this Aboriginal woman saw the costume and felt that this was an example of cultural appropriation, where someone who was white was wearing a costume as an Aboriginal person as, you know, just sort of a fun thing on a holiday, whereas Pocahontas was a real person and, you know, yes, was in a Disney movie, but this was a real person, has a real story, and is tied to a real culture. And so she went up and she spoke to the person and she spoke to the owner of the store and said, this isn't a costume, this is my culture. I want you to understand that this offends me and, you know, you could have worn something else. You don't have to wear, you know, my culture as a costume. And the woman actually ended up getting removed from the mall by security. And she posted on it on Facebook, and my wife happens to be a friend of hers, and I saw it, and I interviewed her about it, and I wrote it. And the initial reaction from people in the comments was, some of them were like, this woman is overreacting, this is ridiculous, like, how far has political correctness gone? Other people were saying, no, this is cultural appropriation, this is wrong. And so the initial reaction was a lot of anger from different angles. And she started getting a lot of hate mail and other things, and it started, you know, getting a lot of attention. And the thing that was really shocking about it was I also interviewed the woman who ran the store, and she said, yes, this woman was overreacting. She shouldn't have made a scene like this. So they were on completely opposite sides of it. And then all this attention started coming to it. And instead of the two of them sitting on their two sides, what actually ended up happening was they got into a conversation over email. And about a few hours after I wrote the article, I heard back from the woman, the first woman who I'd interviewed, and she said, you know what, we've actually talked, and I'm going to come and I'm going to talk to her staff, and I'm going to give them some training on sensitivity for Aboriginal issues, and we're going to work together to figure out ways where they can, you know, celebrate holidays and do things, but in a way that is more culturally sensitive. And so the nicest part of doing that story, because it's like you write the story and then you see how angry people are and how much people are just on different sides and there's nothing that's bringing them together, and the two people, the central people who had the initial conflict, actually came together and figured out a solution. And so then I got to update the story and say that. And for me as a journalist, it actually felt really good to do that. I'm not saying, like, you know, I helped solve the problem, because it was the two of them who did it. It wasn't me. But adding that update was a really good thing. And, you know, we pushed that out over social channels. But I also feel like, you know, we have to find ways to promote that aspect of it better, because I think there was still a lot of anger that was going on between the two of them. The other quick example I want to give is one of our political journalists did a report where she interviewed former drone operators for the Canadian military. This was the first story that had ever been done talking about what their work was in Afghanistan and the post-traumatic stress they've suffered. And it was a really tough story. Like, some of them had attempted suicide and other things. It was a very difficult read, a very important read. And at the end of it, then our journalist actually asked them what their feeling is about the drone program. Because Canada's pushing to get armed drones right now. And they had a lot of very constructive thoughts about what Canada should do with drones. And I'll tell you, honestly, as an editor, my initial thought was, okay, we should probably cut this stuff at the end because we really just want this narrative. And the journalist pushed back and she fought. She's like, no, this is like, this brings it into the present and it's people with this expertise. And yes, it's not their personal stories anymore and it's almost a separate story, but we should have this element of them actually giving this advice and offering something constructive at the end. And so we put that in there, and viewing it in this context, I think that that's a good way to end what is a very tough read, where they're very critical of the military and where they're suffering huge consequences from this. So that's a couple examples from sort of what we do. And just the last thing I wanted to note on the work around debunking misinformation, you know, I think this speaks to one of the big challenges we have, and it was sort of a microcosm in the story about the costume, is there's a tremendous amount of polarization in society. People on different sides of it consume information that reinforces what they believe and not interact with people who feel differently. And what I saw when I was doing debunking work of, like, tracking viral stories and seeing if they were true, is that a lot of times, you know, you think you're offering a solution saying, actually, that thing you saw, this is the truth about it, seems to be, you know, solutions oriented, but a lot of times the reaction people would have is like, oh, you know, why do you have to spoil it? You know, you're ruining the joke, or, you know, you're getting in the way of something that I enjoyed, or in particular, if it's something about a deeply held view, the reaction is, well, you know, I still believe what I believe, and I don't care if that's not true. I think this is one of the big challenges we have, and perhaps this approach to journalism gives us a focus of finding ways to bridge this polarization that is there, because it's there on the political spectrum, it's there on a lot of social justice issues and other really important issues where people are just, you know, they're so far apart and they don't interact, And if we can find ways, you know, to propose things that actually brings them together and forces them to interact, then that's a really, that's something that we're not able to do right now. Because I struggled with that with debunking, where it's like you think you're helping people, but they actually have no interest in finding out what the true information was. So, you know, I would love to hear more about approaches about how we can do that, but I think that's one of the ways that this approach to journalism can help address what is, I think, a really, really core problem that we have in society right now.
Great. Thanks, Craig. Can I just follow up on that last point, really, where you're talking about the audience? Because obviously BuzzFeed, you're not just driven by traffic. You want people to engage and share your business mm-hmm. model, but you are a business and you need to make money. You hinted there that, yes, if you do something positive, if you show a picture of a, you know, kitten or a positive, smiling mm-hmm. story, that sometimes mm-hmm. that gets more shares. But you're also suggesting that people also do like conflict. They like yeah. to see things exposed and revealed and disasters and criticism. So what are the real numbers? When you start doing the more constructive stuff, do people, you know, kind of walk away? Is that the brutal truth that, you know?
I mean, overall, certainly the stuff that is more entertainment-oriented in general gets more traffic, gets shared more. And frankly, I think that's part of the BuzzFeed model, is that you have that whole area of content that's being produced, which generates a lot of engagement, generates a lot of traffic, which I think in a lot of ways attracts the brands that want to work with the company. And I think to me, that's what actually funds us being able to do the journalism. That's the piece of the business model that I think works. But it's also, there's a lot of expertise developed in that area of doing that, that we can apply when we do the journalism. And I think that's a good thing. But yes, absolutely. If I think about the stuff that is most popular that we produce in Canada, it's from what we call the Buzz Team, which are the people who are not doing journalism. They're doing lists and quizzes and things about pop culture. And you know, sometimes there's a hybrid between the two. Like at the end of last year, which is sort of similar to one of the things you were talking about that you guys did, is like the 2013 being the best year ever. At the end of last year, one of the people on our team did a post, I can't remember how many items there were, but it was like, you know, 25 times you were really proud to be Canadian in 2015.
25?
Yeah.
25? Come on.
I can't remember how many it was. Maybe it was 87, because we have so many things to be proud of. And that was a mix. It had some things that were like heartwarming news stories and good things that happened, like, you know, starting to bring in refugees and things like that. And it had some silly sort of viral things that were on there. And it was a mix of the two. And it did really well, but it had elements of the two. And right now, like, are you guys familiar with our prime minister?
Yes.
I mean, my God, like, the interest in Justin Trudeau is insane right now. He does a yoga pose and people go nuts. It was like a yoga pose from 3 years ago, by the way, if you didn't know that. Yeah, it's not even recent. And so it's like we have this, there's this intense positive energy around him, and for our news team, it's like we get a little sick of him, to be honest, you know, but everyone else around the world just wants more of him. And so we, you know, we will publish stuff that's critical of what the government is doing, but we also will do things about, like, you know, how ridiculously adorable he and Obama were in their visit to Washington. So we do both of those things, you know.
Great. Karel, I just want to put a point to you, which is the, you've talked about how you make it work with Correspondent, but do you think that what you're doing is quite marginal? I mean, obviously you're a recent organisation, so you're not going to have millions of readers yet, but do you think that people come to you for a kind of marginal view on things rather than, so they're still going out there and consuming, you know, the mainstream negative news and you're just a little dessert, you're the kind of intellectual side dish? Or do you think you can actually be central and shift the way that mainstream journalism is done?
Well, first of all, I have to say that constructive journalism is not an alternative to journalism, but it's an extra layer. So we always say to our journalists, do all the normal work you have to do for a story to get published, but then do more, go forward. Then as to how marginal or not that is, well, I can say some stories do go viral and reach very large audiences, and particularly the stories that I just mentioned actually worked really well with a larger group than just the people who fund us, basically. So, and I mean, I cannot speak for other media, of course, but I do see constructive elements popping up everywhere. But I don't know if this is because I talk about it all the time. That might be true. It's as if you buy a new car and then suddenly all people have the same car. So, but in general, I think there's a silent majority that is actually tired of news the way it's being presented to them. So I wouldn't say it's a marginal thing at all, actually, because there's a lot of people who are confused and or cynical about the way news is presented to them. And I think we really play into that sentiment by providing them alternatives. We make them less confused by explaining difficult things to them in a way that they can understand it. And we make them less cynical by adding a hopeful or constructive perspective to our stories. So I would say that there's more than just the news junkies there.
Let you come back in on this, but I also want you to come back on that, but I want you to also tell us how can you practically shift the way that journalism happens. Is it about journalism colleges, or is it about newsrooms? How do you, you know, practically shift the way it's made?
What works in my work is to offer trainings to newsrooms, to work directly with editors and journalists. And we start with their values and what that specific newsroom is trying to do in this world, and then we build it from there. So it's about the expanding the mind of the journalist. It's about the story ideas, how to change the brainstorming functions, how to interview or expand the way we interview our sources, killing the victims, maybe also killing the bad guy, asking other questions to power, and also how we engage in this communication with the public. So you can actually enter in many, many, many different ways into the journalistic work process that is already there. And I a short comment on this is not just a niche thing. The European Broadcasting Union, which is the organization of public service broadcasters in Europe, as you of course know, the BBC, Danish Broadcasting, Sweden's Television, and your own broadcasters if you're from Europe, they are right now thinking about establishing an institute or an office for constructive journalism to offer to their public service broadcasters, because it's something that they want to synthesize into the way they cover the news. So it's not just an odd story or a niche thing. So it's actually happening right now on many levels, also into the, you could say, the conventional way that news is being presented. And one last comment is, I wrote a book about this, which is free for download on Amazon.com as an ebook, and it's called From Mirrors to Movers, and it has a lot of practical tools, and it has a lot of examples, and the correspondent in it is in it, and I want to add you, Craig, in the next version, because gathering together all these examples, who's doing what, tools, what's working, what's not working, is really key to establish a robust domain.
Great. Okay, so that's constructive journalism explained. I can see a sea of very cynical and critical faces out there. Has anybody got any questions or comments or suggestions? Put your hands up and then I can see whether, there's loads. That's great. So we'll try and be as quick as we can. We've only got 15 minutes, so keep the questions short and we keep the answers brief.
Okay. Hi, my name is Lisa Rost. I'm an Open Youth Fellow for NPR. I wonder if you make a difference, or if you see a difference between reporting the solutions and actually empowering the audience to work on solutions themselves. Like, for example, with climate change, empowering would not only mean you can do something against climate change with, like, not driving the car so often, but also you can do something with climate change with, like, going into engineering, and these are the organizations who work on climate change, and you could join them and work with them on the solutions.
So what's the difference between constructive and advocacy journalism? That you're saying that how far do you go in terms of actually campaigning or implementing?
Yeah, maybe not so much campaigning, but just like, yeah, presenting the organizations who work on that and like suggesting or like making, suggesting that you can work on that.
Very quickly, so how far would you go, if you don't mind me asking?
briefly, the newsrooms that we are working with comes from niche to more mainstream, and it differs, their attitudes differs. Some don't want to do advocacy, but some do. And the ones that does actually see what they tell us is that they are able to establish a stronger relationship to the region that they serve. But we don't have science telling us anything about it. It's just something that they notice or the feedback they get. So they're establishing stronger ties with the region that they serve. But of course, you can speak more about that.
Yeah, I would say whether or not you are open about it, you will always influence and empower the people who read you. I mean, this engages and empowers people as well, but in a, I would say, more depressing way. So, and in terms of campaigning and how far do you go, when we did this Let's Change from Bank Week, we insistently said, let's do it for 1 week and then shut up about it. I mean, if we were campaigners, we would continue to do so for until we reached our end goal or whatever. But do it in a provocative way that makes people think, so that... And if the, we also said it's also a success if only the editor who wrote this story changed from bank, that then already it is a success. So we didn't really go too far there. Yeah.
Okay. Another question. There's one there, and I'll come to you afterwards. Yeah.
Yes. Hi. My name is Nadia Bellardi. I do training in intercultural communication. I totally support the ethical guidelines for journalists as well as a more transcultural and constructive approach. My concern is, are you making journalists also aware of the fine line to keep their independence and disregards especially funding? Because when I see the video from The Guardian about China engaged for climate change, for me that's a PR storytelling piece. That's not journalism.
Why is it
PR? Because I know perhaps how the PR industry works. I've been in PR myself, and I know how communication and strategies are coming together to make sure certain messages are presented in a positive manner, and there is often money going around along with that. So I think we should all not be naive. I think it's great to put out things that make people think, but the journalists themselves, they still must be able to choose and not be pressured to take on certain topics, because all of a sudden, oh, this will mean we're going to get funding.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Very quickly, so I think in all fairness, it should be The Guardian answering whether or not they've been fed this story, which I doubt, because I think The Guardian is an example of good journalism, but we don't know. But think about this. I think the independence is very important, but aren't we also being dragged around by the negative agenda? I think that we in news journalism, politicians, power holders, they know that we want the conflict. So we are already being dragged around in that. And that's not independence either. I mean, they are speculating on saying something critical about an opposing politicians, and then we'll run with our microphone and cover that. I mean, why is that not something we should think about? So I think it goes for every domain in journalism, every approach. Independence, yes, but don't be naive to think that we are not already being used on the negative agenda.
I'll actually just quickly comment on the previous question. We run sort of global focuses occasionally at BuzzFeed. We did one at the end of last year about mental health. We called it Mental Health Week. So all of, but we're in 11 countries and I think 7 languages right now. So all of those countries, we all produced stuff around mental health. Some of it was, you know, talking about issues, but a lot of the content, particularly the people who are sort of on that buzz side, was about how can we give people, you know, useful strategies and things to help them with their mental health, to take self-care. We have one coming up about it called Body Week. So we proactively sort of choose issues, and then people are sort of free to go after those. But you know, one of the things that happens a lot is I get approached by advocacy organizations and NGOs in Canada who are like, you guys are so good at creating social content, we would like to work with you to create information, you know, awareness about this environmental issue. And we don't do that because, you know, I know that like some of what we do is not journalism, and that's what they're thinking, oh, they'll want to partner with us. But we do have a news organization, we do have standards, and so we initiate our own sort of campaigns. We do not, you know, align with a specific organization, which maybe falls into that second piece too.
Exactly. Let's take another call. We've only got 5 minutes, so gentlemen there. Who else has got their hand up?
Hi, I'm Shujai Gupta from the Herald, Goa in India. My question is there too much of a contradiction between negative journalism and constructive journalism? I don't think the gap is huge, because sometimes you need to put out those hard negative stories to be constructive, and the stories themselves is your act of constructive journalism. See, for instance, if a minister is not releasing power connections to companies because he wants a bribe, or if another powerful politician is grabbing a lot of land for a IT park and not paying compensation to the poor villager, you need to put out that strong story, and that is your act of constructive journalism, because there can be no solutions to this except the fact that this guy, the powerful, have to stop, you know, pressurizing and subjugating the weak.
Yeah, that's a really good point. I'm not going to get you to answer, I'm going to get another question in. Sorry, just quickly this one question here. Now at the front here, very quickly, and then I'm going to get people
okay.
To wrap up.
Hello, my name is Sanjali. So I have a question. Do you have any practical tips? How can we bring in constructive journalism into the daily newsroom? Because like I understand, for example, for BuzzFeed or if for a blog, then it could be very easy for journalists to do a deep research and actually bring in the constructive part of journalism. But for daily news, like usually get resources from agencies and so on, and you have to create a news piece within the shortest time. And how can you actually in this way bring it to be constructive? Because very often you get the information from agencies.
Really good point. So just to end, one comment from each of you about how, you know, in a crowded newsroom with all this stuff coming in, negative imagery, storylines, one tip to the journalist in that newsroom about how they could be more constructive. And let's start here.
Read my book.
Good, that's it.
Well, this, I don't want to sound arrogant or superficial, but it has a lot of tips and practical tools in it, and I think it's about the mindset of the journalist.
Karel?
Yeah, I would say it's not either critical journalism or constructive journalism, but it's and you have to do both. So, for instance, the Panama Papers, very important stuff. And about the second question, you don't really have to cover the news. I mean, the news is everywhere. What people pay journalists for is to make them understand why this matters and to put things into perspective, I would say. So when Brussels happened, the attacks, we decided not to publish stories for a day. And we communicated to our readers. And much to our surprise, they thanked us for it. Thank you for not doing anything. So that was the constructive thing to do then. Because it was too early.
Craig?
I think one approach, and I'm even thinking about some ways that we can do this with some things we've recently been covering as more of sort of an ongoing story, but I think you can do the constructive approach. It's like a great sort of second day story or third day story, where it's like, yes, okay, there's a problem, let's talk about that, and let's make sure we reveal everything about that, but then you can actually come back to it and, you know, as your second day or your follow-up on it, to say, all right, let's shift to some of the other ways that this could be done. And I think that's one way, like you may have to just deal with the breaking stuff and the evolving things as they come, but then you can sort of sit back and say, okay, so, you know, what is an approach that might make this different? And so a good follow-up or day two story is probably a way to do it.
Excellent. Listen, if you want to know more about constructive journalism, or at least what I think about it, if you go on my Twitter feed, Charlie Beckett, there's a link to an article I wrote for The Guardian, there's a link to a radio documentary I did on the subject for the BBC, and also there's details of a big free journalism conference that we're having at the London School of Economics on April the 21st, which is going to be all about a reporting crisis, and we will be talking a bit about constructive journalism there as well. Thank you for your brilliant questions. Thank you to the panel for their incredibly constructive approach to journalism this morning. Thanks very much, everyone.